And there are a lot of them, but first we want to thank our panelists for staying with us just a little bit longer, and we do want to get right to the questions. So here's one. When will a COVID-19 vaccine be available for children? I'm going to send that one to Dr. Yeletti, who is a member of the community health organization staff there, team member there.
Sure. So I think what we need to remember, the primary purpose of the vaccine, first and foremost, is to reduce deaths. So the reason we're going from 80, 70, and 50, 60 and 50 is that in the past month, over 2,000 Hoosiers have died. And so with this vaccine, that number is going to drop dramatically in the next 60 days. And so we want to make sure we survive. In terms of children, that will be delayed, and that's intentional because children, it's very rare to get a severe disease in children. And so it's very important that we really vaccinate everybody that could potentially get severe disease. And the chance of a child getting a severe disease and not doing well is small. So there is a time. It's not that they're not important, but it's prioritization. And so they will be much later. And also the studies we've done so far haven't been studied in children yet, below, what I mean by children is below age 16 or age 18, depending on the study. So it will happen, but it's not going to happen in the near future, though.
I've got a quick question here. We heard from some viewers who are wondering why we haven't reported on flu deaths this year. In Indiana, we understand. State Health Department reports 3 influenza deaths so far this season. Question, is this lower than normal? And the second question, is it possible that the COVID precautions are helping to slow the spread of influenza? Anyone want to take that one?
I could.
Okay, Dr. Yoletti, go ahead.
One thing is that, so the amazing thing about flu vaccine is that actually wearing a mask and washing your hands is how you reduce flu. And so in our hospitals today, we have over 1,000 beds. We have minimal people with the flu. And the reason is that the precaution for COVID is exactly the same precaution for flu. So amazing enough, we have very few deaths, but not even people hospitalized. And it's because the precautions for both are identical.
I thought this was an interesting question. Are there plans to develop a COVID-19 missed vaccine like we have with the flu missed vaccine? Anyone of you can answer that.
I can take that question. So it seems like some company has already done a nasal version of the vaccine, and they are dependent on the same technology which are there, especially adenoviral vector-based vaccine. And in animal, they are working well. They are going in human trial. And once the human trials are done, then these, you can say, drop in the nose or mist in the nose, those vaccine can be available if the safety and efficacy are good enough.
Okay, so it sounds like that's in the works in some respect. Dr. Imbe, again, will the vaccine protect against the new strains of COVID, or will there have to be variations and changes made to the vaccine as these new strains become available? We are reporting now that at this point, it looks like the current vaccine does protect against this newest strain, but could that change?
Yeah, that's right. So far, all indications are that the vaccines and the way they've been developed and what they target do in fact protect, as best we can tell, against the new strains. Is it conceivable that with additional mutations, there could be some resistance that develops to vaccine? Yes, that is possible. So far, we are not seeing that, and we certainly hope that doesn't happen. One of the keys is decreasing the mutation rate, which happens when you decrease the degree to which it is passing through the population and continuing to replicate. Every replication cycle, everybody that's infected, more chance for that virus to mutate and therefore develop some immunity. So one of the other reasons to try to get this under control, in addition to the most important reasons about protecting everyone's lives, is to also decrease the chances that it will mutate. But so far, so good, as best we know, and we just have to keep an eye on this.
So Dr. Imbe, I want to stay with you for a little bit, and maybe Professor Mattel may have something to add with this as well. You know, we talk about this virus oftentimes, and we're all still learning about it. So when we say something like a COVID-19 strain, how does that happen, the mutations? You touched on that a little bit, Dr. Imbe, but how does something that we've never seen before come into our society and then start mutating and creating new strains that could also pose a danger to us? So let me start with Dr. Imbe. I'll go to Dr. Mattel, and then I saw I think Dr. Yoletti nodding too, so we'll start with the three gentlemen there. So Dr. Imbe, you first.
I'll answer briefly, and then I'd love to hear Professor Mattel's answer to this too. So throughout history, we know that this is unfortunately what happens. We do have mutation, meaning changes in the code of these viruses. And when they pass from species to species and they replicate, there's a chance every time that happens that there's some changes to that code that eventually leads to a sufficient enough change that makes it possible for that to jump into another species like humans. And that's what we expect happened in this case, is that it went from some animal species to humans, and then it can continue to mutate. And sometimes those mutations result in weakening, and sometimes they result in strengthening, if you will. But Professor Mittal, please, you're the expert.
That's certainly I can add my thought. So what happens in viruses, especially RNA viruses? Their polymerase, which are making the copy of the virus genome, which is RNA genome, when they are making the copy, that process is faulty. It does not have as good as proofreading capability, so it can add error. So when the error are acceptable, that protein is being made and everything is there, so that is counted as mutation. It could be good or it could be bad for the virus. So that's the one reason of having the mutation. Second reason is, as soon as we started having the immune response, again, the immune pressure, the virus keep on changing because it need to survive in those people. So one thing is faulty, the mechanism of replication. And the second thing is the immune pressure. And that's why flu is mutating. That's the same way this coronavirus is mutating.
Wow. I feel like if I had Dr. Mittal as my professor back in college, I might have sticked with becoming a doctor. My mom is probably watching now like, see, you could have done it. Just so fascinating. Dr. Yoledi, anything to add here about the science and how we get those strains?
Yeah, the only, I think that's the excellent remarks by Professor Mittal. The one thing I might add simply is that sheer volume of the virus, 50 million people around the world infected. So these viruses are constantly having minor changes. And when you have so much of the virus out there, some of those minor changes, if they're actually beneficial for the virus, they become more hardy. So then they can actually infect more people. A lot of the mutations are really minor and they don't make the virus better. So then they just die off. But when you have 50 million people getting the virus, there's millions of small mutations, vast majority don't have an issue, but the ones that are good, those viruses get really hardy and they start infecting more people. So it's actually expected that we would start seeing some mutations just with sheer volume of people getting it.
Another question. We're going to direct this to Nurse Hammerly. We understand that you are very passionate about reaching as many communities as possible to promote vaccinations. And you apparently wanted to take this opportunity to address the Latino community. So tell us why that's important to you, and then deliver your message, if you'd like, directly to that audience.
Can I do it in Spanish?
Sure, both. That'd be fine.
Absolutely. We have seen an increase in our patient population that have had COVID, and our Hispanic population, and also our Black community. They have been hit even more than our Anglo patients. So I find it that sometimes the lack of understanding the language barrier among the Hispanic has been something that it contributes to that. So I'm tremendously passionate about information gives you power. Information and knowledge gives you power. So if I can do anything to change one person's perception regarding vaccination and regarding prevention of this disease, by all means, I will definitely do so. And if I may, I would like to do that right now.
Go right ahead.
A nuestros oyentes latinos, lo que quiero asegurarles es que tómense el tiempo para investigar acerca de las vacunas. Las vacunas son importantes. Hemos estado vacunándonos por décadas y en este momento es importante que continuemos haciéndolo con el COVID. También continúen tomando las medidas de precaución, lavándose las manos, manteniendo la distancia. Todas esas cosas contribuyen a que podamos combatir este virus. Thank you.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
That's great.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, there have been some reports. There's a federal database that's tracking numbers that has numbers of people dying after receiving the vaccine. Not sure. It's not clear whether the vaccine is causing some of these deaths, but we understand it is concerning for Hoosiers who are lining up to take the shot. We asked Dr. Weaver about these cases. I don't know if we have that soundbite, Maria, from Dr. Weaver. If we do, let's play that. And then if any of you want to address that after this soundbite, we can come out to that. But I think that some of the numbers were more than 50 people have been reported to this federal database. So here's what Dr. Weaver had to say first.
So it has been reported to take into consideration vaccinating people who are terminally ill, so people who are actively dying or very sick, not giving them the vaccine. Honestly, that's part of all vaccine processes. It's the first question on the screening form with the CDC for these vaccines to see if someone is acutely ill. That and you know, the thought process is that this will cause an immune response that may be overwhelming to someone who's acutely ill. Plus, people who are sick might not have the correct immune response, so may not get all the antibodies that they need in order to be able to be fully immunized. So I have heard about that. There has been reports. I know specifically it came out of Norway. So we'll continue to look to the CDC to give us further guidance. We've had over 300,000 people vaccinated here in Indiana, and of course, you know, millions across the globe. So just, again, continue to pay close attention to that, to all the data that's coming out, but it has been proven safe and efficacious.
All right, we're going to open up to anyone on the panel. Would any of you like to address that as well?
I would like to make one. I think it's a very, very important topic. I'm glad you brought it up, is that in the studies, you had 75,000 people in the two studies that got approved by the FDA, and nobody died in those related to the vaccine. People have died, but not related to the vaccine, to natural causes. And I think it's very, very important that people don't fear the vaccine for death. We've had, again, in the past month with Hoosiers, we've had more than 2,000 Hoosiers die. In the past month, we've vaccinated 400,000 Hoosiers and none of them died. So you have to remember that getting COVID, you have a much higher chance of dying, and getting the vaccine, it's almost zero. And we don't, and as Dr. Weaver said, we don't even think those deaths that are remotely out there are related to the virus or the vaccine at all. So please understand that getting COVID is much worse than getting the vaccine.
I think I was going to just jump in there, Rachel, just to mention something. I think some of this information is coming out of a study out of Norway. This is what Dr. Weaver was talking about, and there's just a lot of questions about it, and people need to not make that any kind of definitive conclusion and conclusion from that particular study. So she mentioned that in her soundbite. But anyway, Bichelle, go ahead.
And we also talked with her about some other topics too, because one of our viewers asked if the state has plans to deliver vaccines to those who are homebound. So here's what she had to say on that.
Yes, we are putting things into place and some pilot programs where we can provide the vaccine to people who are at home. So we'll be working really closely with hospitals, local health departments, and then different agencies who would specifically have the ability to outreach to those patients, or if we're identifying them when, our areas the agencies of aging are calling people and they identify that they're homebound, to make sure that they can get connected. So that is part of our plan.
I have a question about pregnancy, and I don't know if we touched on this a little bit earlier. I have a surgeon friend at Cornell University who's saying that they are recommending, he's a neonatal surgeon, he says he's recommending that women who are pregnant go ahead and get the vaccine because there's just not a lot of data yet. They'd rather be safe than sorry. What are we telling, or what are you, Dr. Uletti, anyone who wants to speak to this, what are you telling patients? Because initially we heard they were recommending against pregnant women getting vaccinated, and now that may be changing. So where does that stand if anyone watching has that type of a question?
I think, as we said before, those are critical decisions to talk to your OB physician about. It's on a case-by-case basis. The reason that the recommendations were kind of vague is that the studies didn't have enough people to really make a strong recommendation. But once again, when you talk to your physician about it, you have to think, if you're pregnant, what if you get COVID when you're pregnant? And so what is the risk of you having to carry a baby with COVID versus getting the vaccine? So that's why it's a one-on-one discussion with your physician. But I would personally recommend, depending on the situation, more likely than not to get the vaccine.
Okay.
Let's send a question now over to Kristen Kelly. I know you work at IU Health and you're the Director of Infection Prevention. There's a lot of people who, while we're comfortable with COVID-19 in terms of how to prevent it, they're still a little bit worried about coming to the hospital, going to the doctor's office if they feel sick. So what do you tell people who are watching right now who may be experiencing symptoms, who aren't feeling well, or, you know, have nothing to do with COVID-19 but just need to see a doctor? What do you tell them about going to your hospital or really any hospital in Indiana right now?
Yeah, so we definitely say do not put off your doctor's visit or your trip to see your NP or any other planned trip. In fact, I think some of the hospitals are some of the safest places to be right now because we have personal protective equipment everywhere. We're cleaning everything, disinfecting everything, and we put a lot of thought and care into making sure it's a safe environment. So even though, you know, these places can be filled with COVID patients, we make sure that we isolate these patients appropriately, that if you were to come in contact with any of them, which you wouldn't during your trip, that they would be isolated away from the general public, and that we would make sure to give you a mask upon your entry to the hospital, as well as encourage you to clean your hands. So we're doing a lot of coaching of the general public. Your safety is super important to us, and we take a lot of time to make sure it's done right. So don't fear, don't worry. If you have questions, we'll answer them when you get here. And definitely make sure to get your preventative, you know, health check done. That's super important right now.
All right, Kristen, thank you. And along the same lines, I want to go to Courtney Kritz, who was with IEMS. You have to transport these patients oftentimes to the hospital. So what are the things that you all are doing to make sure people are safe as COVID-19 continues to impact our community?
As Kristen said, we are, you know, taking all the precautions. We're wearing our PPE on every run with every single patient. We are giving patients masks if they don't have them already, because you have to have a mask to go to the hospital, to be in the hospital. As she said, everyone in the hospital is wearing masks. We are wearing our respirators, our eye protection, our gloves, our gowns, depending on the call. So we are taking all the precautions. We're disinfecting things after the call's over. We're disinfecting everything that the patient came in contact with. And then we see it at the hospitals as well. You know, the hospitals are doing a great job of cleaning everything, keeping patients separate that have COVID, as she said. So it's really safe. We really want everyone, if you need us, call us. Don't be scared to go to the hospital because of COVID.
We've got to our panelists, and we are kind of running out of time, but I want to get a final thought from everybody in our group here. It's just such great minds and great hearts. So let's start with Professor Mattel. Just some final thoughts as we go around Robin here, and it doesn't have to be long, but we just want to get your message if you were to push it out there during this show.
So I'd just like to ask people of Indiana to go out and get vaccinated, and if they have some questions, they can go to the website of Indiana government as well as CD website. There's tons of information available. So getting vaccine is more important than getting our life back pretty soon. Okay. If we won't get vaccination, then the disease can linger on.
Great. Final thoughts, panel? Dr. MB?
Yes. Well, I certainly agree with that sentiment. I would say that this has clearly been an incredibly difficult year, incredibly difficult time, and, you know, it's a once in a hundred year event. And as challenging as it has been, it's going to go on for a bit longer, but it is temporary after all. And so we just have to continue to do everything that everybody's been talking about in terms of taking precautions, making sure that we continue to do what's necessary to keep this trend going in the right direction. We continue to pursue as quickly as we can getting vaccinated and taking care of each other. And the more we can do that, the more we can get control of this and get back to normal sooner than later.
Nurse Hammerly, what would you like to say?
Three words: vaccinate, vaccinate, and vaccinate. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's what it boils down to.
All right, that sounds good. Dr. Yoletti, would you like to say anything finally?
Yeah, I think, Thanksgiving and Christmas is hard because you couldn't hug your loved ones and have dinner together. That's going to happen very soon. As our grandparents and parents get vaccinated, you can start hugging your children. This is a bright, bright year. And all it takes is everybody getting vaccinated to really get back to the social people that we are. So very exciting.
And Ms. Creed, would you like to say something?
Just as everyone else said, you know, get vaccinated when you can. This is the beginning of the end of this. So that's just really important that we get out, everyone gets out, gets vaccinated as soon as they possibly can so we can get this thing over with.
And final thoughts from everybody else. We're opening it up at this point. We don't want to put you on the spot, but if you do have a final thought, we'd like for you to share it.
Well, I would just say, oh, sorry, Kristen.
No, go ahead.
One thing I'd say is working as a director of infection prevention, I've seen, you know, the horrors of COVID and the worst of what this virus can do. But we've also seen the best of what our community can do, seeing our healthcare workers, our first responders, you know, rise to the challenge and take care of each other, stepping into tremendous fear and hardship to do the right thing has been so hopeful. Also seeing this vaccine come, you know, to us in record time, it is like hope in a jar. And seeing our 70s and our 80-year-olds walk into these clinics proudly, ready for their shot, has given us so much hope in the healthcare community after seeing like the worst of it. And so we're just tremendously excited and blessed to have what we feel like is hope in a jar. So, you know, definitely get your shot when it's your time, you know, take your shot and know that you can do that confidently because the healthcare community and the scientists have really, really feel reassured that it's safe and it works. And if you're not quite ready yet, just stay open, continue to get good information from good sources online, talk to people that you trust, talk to your doctor, and, you know, just keep open and hopefully you'll do it when the time is right. So,
okay. All right. Well, we want to say once again, thank you to all of you for joining us. Thank you on behalf of the entire Central Indiana community for your tireless dedication to the health of so many people that you don't know. You truly are selfless servants, and we are grateful for you. God bless you all, and let's continue, like we said, to pray for so many who are suffering tonight and who are still praying for help.
And we know that many of you are still looking for resources. You may have questions. We have so much online, so please visit us at fox59.com as well as cbs4indy.com too.
You're all heroes, and we're just thankful that you all participated in the show, and we'll keep you updated. This is a big story. Thank you for being with us.
And thank you for joining us.